those of us who are younger, we would have more choices and more options. And there'd be a traditional Medicare program, just like it is right now. So if you wanted to just go right on Medicare and turn, you know, what is it now, 64, right? It's not Medicare, 62, retired early in Social Security. So you can go right on Medicare. Or you'd have options of other plans. And the federal government would put out to bid in each region of the country. They'll ask, you know, all the different companies to come in, put bids in for plans. And the second lowest plan, second lowest bid, would be the amount that they would use for that area. So everybody would be entitled to that premium support of that amount of money. And they could choose to go on traditional Medicare, or they could choose to buy another Medicare plan. And there might be plans that include dental, vision, or gym memberships. There might be people who might want to pay a little more for a plan that's more encompassing than they have right now. This is what all the farmers are here to do every year. This is what they do in Congress. The farmers may have all these choices for their own health care, right? But for everybody else, it's considered radical if you're giving other people the option to do the same thing that they're doing. So, you know, that's what's being talked about.
And how does that compare to what the Medicare would be? Well, I don't understand why people would just say that.
Because you're somebody who maybe you would want
to. You said you want the vision and the dental.
Maybe you'd want it. Maybe you want your division dental in it. Maybe you want your pharmaceuticals in it. Maybe you get a free gym membership. Maybe, you know, you can shop around. Like right now, most younger people right now have a choice when they're working for an employer, they have a choice of a whole bunch of different healthcare options that you can take. And, you know, that's basically under that plan, that's what they're talking about allowing. And the thought is that if you have a bunch of insurance companies that are competing against each other, and, you know, in this competition, that they'll drive the cost down. So if anybody who wants to just stay on traditional Medicare will be able to do it. You know, so it isn't, you're basically giving people more choices. And I'll tell you what they do is that they're going out right now and scaring the seniors, because again, like I said at the beginning, there isn't one thing anywhere that's being talked about that anybody 55 years or older would be affected. But people like John Tierney is sending, how many people get the flyers in their house? Yeah. You know, they'll send a flyer out and saying, you know, the picture of an old person, Richard Tisei is going to take away my Medicare, you know. And this is the problem in Washington, is you have dishonest people like John Tierney, right, who scare everybody, and you know, everybody's afraid to put out their plan. You know, like that. None of the congressmen want to put a plan on the table, because what will happen is, it turns out that 5 months later, you know, there's a commercial with them pushing their grandmother around the cliff. And that's the problem. That's why our country is in so much trouble right now. All the demonization that takes place, you know, on a day-to-day level. And, you know, again, you know, I don't think it's right for Democrats to just push through something without any Republican support, or Republicans to push through anything without any Democratic support. The only way the problem's going to be solved is we've got to sit down together and say, let's put all the politics aside and try to put something in place that's going to help people, not just right now, but the future of the generations down the road. Because you need to have people in Washington who will do what's right and not necessarily for leadership health. And, you know, and no, but there, you know, there are people who are very, you know, who are good people down there who want to work together to get things done. You know, the problem is the leadership of both parties. You have a guy like John Tierney who votes 99% of the time with Nancy Pelosi. So when issues come up, like the medical device thing, you voted, you know, for the medical device caps. Well, everybody in this district is like, you know, I mean, there's so much to lose, but, you know, they're just rubber stamps. And on the Republican side, you have a group of people who are doing the same thing. And I guess, you know, the way to get out of the mess that we're in is elect people who, you know, who have beliefs and, you know, but also who are willing to say, you know what, I don't agree with the leadership on this. I'm going to do what I think is right. And if there are more people like that in Congress, a lot of these will force the leaders to have to sit down and try to negotiate something. Yeah?
I was fortunate enough to work in the Pentagon for a while, and I have great concerns about national security, and knowing that you're going to be having to deal with scarce resources. How do you feel about the size of the force, weapons platforms, R&D, as far as military is concerned? Where does that sort of sit in your pecking order of spending money?
Well, if you look at the Constitution, like the first responsibility of the federal government is to protect the country. And we're living like in a world right now that's really getting more and more dangerous by the day. I think I said earlier, one spark in the Middle East would just turn into a huge, you know, a war. So making sure that we properly protect the country is, you know, is extremely important. That said, you know, I think we have troops right now, or a military presence in 149 countries around the world. And I think places like South Korea, that are very wealthy countries, can help put the bill for some of the things that we're doing to protect them. And I think probably Germany and some of the NATO countries could probably step up and do a little more, instead of the United States having to do everything. And I do think that, you know, it should be politicians who decide really what the proper size, you know, the proper troop levels are to protect the country. We should be listening to our military experts say, you know, if these different scenarios happen, this is what we need in place as far as weapon systems, personnel. You know, it shouldn't be a situation where we have a sequester, which I was talking about earlier, when you have an across-the-board cut that that's really an impact. You know, like you see it already right now, with one of the defense contractors in the district, and I said, you know, you don't really see it on the surface, but all of the, you know, the Patriot missiles that break, you know, they're stopping firing them, right, you know, they're cutting back on all the systems that they, the supplies that they need. And if something pops up tomorrow, and, you know, say Israel attacks Iran, and all of a sudden we're engulfed in this big regional war, we want to make sure that we're here to kind of be.
It's been my experience, though, that there have been a lot of wasteful programs because some of these districts, they don't want to stop just jobs. So therefore, we spend a lot of useless money.
I said this before you came in, but I run into federal employees all the time, or federal contract employees, and they'll tell me, I can't believe the amount of money that's wasted. Mm-hmm. And certainly the procurement system on the defense side, there's a lot of things that you can do to run more like a business and save money. I mean, I have no doubt. I mean, they're already cutting the defense budget before they ever talk about the sequester, you know, so it's something people recognize. Well, his record's pretty interesting during the whole budget debate. You know, I mean, there are differences. You know, he thinks that the way to get the economy moving again right now is another stimulus from spending. I kind of think, I think the opposite, that we had one in place that didn't end up working. He thinks higher taxes are the way to go. We voted for $4 trillion in taxes. Tax increases is part of the budget process. I think that you don't want to increase the rates really topic. So, you know, there are definitely different approaches to how you handle things. Yeah.
Yeah, Richard, first of all, I have to thank God we have a term on the president.
You know what? It's something that I've been thinking about a lot. Additionally, I didn't think term limits were a good idea because you're up every 2 years and you have to put yourself before the voters. But seeing the way that Washington works right now, you know, I'm becoming more and more of a fan of term limits. I myself personally, I'll tell you that if I'm fortunate enough to be able to represent this district, I don't plan to do it for 10 or 15 years. I feel like I've already had a career in public service in a private sector company. I want to be able to work on, I want to just basically, people say, why are you running? I'm like, I want to go out to Washington and help save the country. And I think we're in this period right now, in the next 2 or 4 years, is going to determine everything, what kind of country we're going to be at the end of the day. And I'll be out to Washington, I won't worry so much about how this vote will help me and that vote will help me in the re-election campaign. I want to just go be able to go down and help straighten things out. And I do think that, you know, clearly, to a large extent, the problem down in Washington right now is that you have all these people who are down there, and like I said, it's the only part of the country that's thriving. The real estate market's doing really well. Everybody's doing really well. There's just like a disconnect between what's happening in Washington and the average person, and there's an arrogance down there right now. I think, you know, we see it here in our district, that you don't have to answer questions. There are two sets of rules, you know, one for you, one for everybody else. That's what happens when you're in Washington too long or you're in the public office for too long.
I think if you publicly came up and said that you would only spend X years in office, yep, and you would resign, that, I mean, that you believe in term limits, I think you would gain a lot of political leverage.
Well, there was something published not that long ago that showed all the lengths of time that people have been in the Senate and Congress, and it just blew me away. I could not believe.
Is there any way we can reduce farm money? I think a lot of it doesn't even know where it's supposed to go.
I think like the foreign aid. I was just talking about foreign aid. And I think, you know, can we reduce foreign aid? And I would say that, you know, the United States as a country should be very cognizant of who our friends are. We should be trying to influence countries in the right way. You know, a lot of people are upset right now that they're talking about giving Egypt additional foreign aid in addition to what they normally get. You know, if you want to help, if you have a carrying stick and you can help move countries towards democracy and respect individual rights, that's a good thing, but you know, but also if a country is not respecting individual rights and is diametrically opposed to the United States on a lot of different issues, I think you should review that, and I don't think that we should be, you know, propping countries up. The way they're using the programs, believe it or not, I mean, we're borrowing 40 cents on the dollar from China, but we're also giving China foreign aid for environmental issues, and we're giving them foreign aid for family planning issues. And so I think, you know, I think it's probably what we should do.